welcome to another video going through my ELO vinyl collection. The last video was the early years of Jet finishing with a new world record. So we're going to kick off with ELO's seventh album, which is Magnificent Out of the Blue. And anyone that's seen my ELO's ranking video for the albums will know that I think highly of this album, as many people do. So this was ELO's only studio double album, came out in 1977, and the cover is quite iconic, a huge album cover from the 70s. I believe it was created by a Japanese airbrush artist. Open it out and have a look inside. This image is probably a little slightly less familiar to some folk that don't have the album. So that's a gorgeous image of the interior of the Fantasy ELO spaceship, and you can see some figures there. If you look closely, they're all meant to be individuals. I think that's Jeff and Bev in the centre, with Richard right in the middle there, obscured by the centrefold, with Kelly over this side, just at the end, Mick Kaminsky, and I think Mel and Hugh over on this side. It's a great album. Made top 10, number 4, I think, in the UK. And then this helped solidify the back of a new world record, ELO's global popularity. And by this time, they'd become one of the biggest bands on the planet around 1977 through to sort of 79. So what do we get in this? Well, we get two inners with the lyrics, same both sides, two like that. We get a poster. So Jet went to town on this album. This is now that ELO had become such a success, they went to town on the on the stuff you got with the LP. So we get a nice poster with portraits of the band members there. This isn't the album I had when it came out. I had a cheap Portuguese import and I stuck the poster on the wall, so that's a copy that's well beaten up and seen better days. But this is a really excellent condition copy, so that's good. We also get the cardboard spaceship. This was something given out with the first sort of few copies. Not every copy's got this. Most copies have got the poster. That shouldn't be too difficult to find. But the cardboard spaceship intact is difficult to find. So I'm not even going to attempt to get that, put that together. That's going to stay like that inside the LP forever, evermore. And a flyer. So this is the first time that an ELO album in the UK had a flyer with it. T-shirts. Most of the Secret albums started having flyers advertising t-shirts, back catalogue of the LPs, pictures, badges, buttons, that sort of thing. So that's the album. Now what else came out of that at this time? Well, there were four singles taken from Out of the Blue. The first one was Turned to Stone. Not easy to find in really good nick like this. I think this was an ex-old stock shop copy I bought off eBay a few years back, so it's a nice condition copy of that one. So that's Turned to Stone, got into the top 20 in the UK. Follow-up is the very well-known Mr. Blue Sky, which has since become an iconic 70s song, not just for the sake of its ELO, but you know, advertising on TV, advertising the 70s, that sort of thing. It's a song that gets a lot of airplay on the radio. Everybody's heard this. This copy is on blue vinyl, which is quite nice. It's not too difficult to find on eBay or other outlets. Sleeve condition is everything, of course. Single number 3 from Out of the Blue is Wild West Hero. So that's that cover shot there was taken when the band were doing the video EP, when they were putting the songs to some videos. On the back of the cover, you've got basically album advertisements, which became quite typical of the back cover, a lot of Jet releases around this time. And the fourth single from Out of the Blue is Sweet Talking Woman. This came out, I think, it was around about September 78, when ELO were in the middle of their world tour. So we got a live shot of the famous spaceship stage there with the laser lights helping to form the song title there. Looks really nice. Back cover, more adverts for the albums, but also a live shot of the string section on stage from around that period. This one, Sweet Talking Woman, came out in blue vinyl, purple vinyl, sorry. This one also happens to be a demo copy of the record, nice purple vinyl. Again, not too difficult to find in terms of the actual record. So all of those were top 10 hits for ELO at the time, apart from Turn to Stone. Also, my collection, less known to many people, will be Jeff Lynne's first foray into a solo career. He had a song came out around this period called Doing That Crazy Thing. Aren't too many copies is about, even less with a picture sleeve. That's not a perfect condition sleeve, but it's pretty good. You'll recognise the photo there of Jeff. That's, I think, from maybe the On the Third Day photo sessions, can't be too sure. And some graphics there showing people doing some crazy things. It looks like some sort of Victorian publication. It's not typical ELO music, to be honest with you. It's very disco, reggae sort of orientated, and the B-side going down to Rio's much in the same tone. So it's a bit of a novelty standalone record. Bevan had tried it a couple of years early, 1976, with the instrumental at Derby Drums. So Jeff had a go a year or two later. Didn't really do anything, consequently it's not too easy to find. I think it came out in the States as well, and possibly even on 12-inch in the States, but as far as I'm aware, just that 7-inch in the UK. Right, so that is out of the blue stuff, with the exception of two more things, sorry, a couple of 12 inches here. So this, get it out of the generic sleeve, is Wild West Hero and 12-inch on yellow vinyl. This is not too easy to find. You will find it, but it's not as common as some of the other coloured vinyls. So it utilises the New World Record logo label, as you can see there with the traditional jet label on the reverse. So there's no picture sleeve for this, and that's the very good reason for that is that when World War II was released, it crept up into the sort of top 40 of the chart and then started going back down the charts. And it wasn't getting the exposure that the record company and the band were looking for. So Jet Records very, very quickly pressed up 10,000 copies of these, literally over the weekend, overnight, and got them into the shops straight away. And they must have been quite clever in picking the shops that they knew would report back on chart figures, because that alone got Wild West Hero back up the charts and eventually to the top 10 and became one of their classic songs. So that's the story behind the 12-inch. And that's why there is no picture sleeve. There wasn't time to organise one. Even just a blow up of the 7-inch single sleeve, it would have meant waiting for printing to become available, etc. So so that's that one. Nice record all the same. There was a second 12-inch from Out of the Blue, and it is The Sweet Talking Woman. This is a blow up sleeve copy of the 7-inch. And it looks better, I think, actually. Although it looks nice as 7-inch, it looks great as a 12-inch cover, and it's proper thick card cover. It also comes on purple vinyl, which is the only colour this comes in at 12-inch is purple vinyl. There is no black vinyl version, in case anybody thinks that there is one out there to be hunted down. There isn't, it's just the purple. And it, again, because they make so many of these, it's not too difficult to find this one. You should be able to get this reasonably easy if you look around. So that is all of the UK Out of the Blue releases. Let's just make some room here. Okay, so what's next? Well, right at the back end of 1978, we get the first box set by ELO. So this is called Three Light Years. Most people in the UK are familiar with this. You get lots of copies of this about. It actually charted, even though it's a box set of re-released LPs, and it sold quite well. So you'll find this at car boots, second-hand record stores, record fairs. Condition, of course, is another thing. It's a cardboard box, so over the years, various copies have got beaten up, etc. All the LPs have got separated from the box. The back of it just shows you the album Tigers and the track listing. So Three Light Years, it's a play on the fact that it's three LPs covering 3 years. On the Third Day, 1973, Eldorado, 1974. Facing 1975. there's no new music in here, it's just a repressing and a representation of the original albums. So what do we get? Well, we get the LPs come out in nice poly bags with the ELO logo printed on it. We get LP sleeve on the label there, it's quite nice, and a generic blue Free Lightless label on the reverse there, and they're all like that, and it's just a different way of presenting LPs. You also get this nice LP sized book inside. That cover of that is a reverse cover of the Face the Music band shot. Inside you get credits for the band as existed at the time, at the time the box set came out at least. You get shots of the original LP cover plus any photos of the band that may have included in the original artwork for those albums, and the song titles and lyrics. The photos shown here are EO Live pretty much around this period, probably heading towards 1970, well, going up to 1978 to be perfectly honest with you, so that's clearly from the Out of the Blue era. But then again, this is when this box set was released, so they didn't want to keep too many old photos in here. And that's it, some credits at the end. And you also get a flyer, a bigotry flyer. This one is for the ELO fan club, which came out around 1978. So as I said before, ELO being a very popular band by this point in time, they decided to get a fan club together. I don't think many bands these days would initiate a fan club by the time they'd released their seventh album. It would be quite rare for anybody to do that. Things either take off immediately now or they don't. And there for some, I think it's a t-shirt again. So there we go, that's Three Light Years. There was a single released to promote this box set, and it looks like this. Nice artwork, I think. This is actually one of my favourite ELO single covers. I know it's just the logo on a sky background, but it's very well presented, it's very well done. I like the glowing of the font there, and it's on a nice car cover, so it's in really good condition. Advert for the boxes at the back. So this scraped into the top 40. It's got Can't Get Out of My Head, Strange Magic, Mama Ma Bell, and Evil Woman on it. So tracks selected from the three LPs included in the box set. Can't Get Out of My Head was chosen as the lead track because it didn't do anything on its initial release 4 years earlier, but it did just about chart this time around. And an oddity related to that is a jukebox only release where they put Can't Get Out of My Head on one side and Evil Woman on the other. Obviously that's not a commercial release, but you can get copies of this on eBay from time to time, which is where I got this one. Okay, so before we close out with 78 and going into 79, it's worth mentioning that Jet Records went through a change around this time. They'd initially been with distributor United Artists, and they had a falling out with United Artists, so I won't go into the details on that. It's commercial related to United Artists flogging Out of the Blue with the wrong master tape or something like that. And there was a falling out, and Jet went over to CBS. So what they did was, and the LPs got re-released again with different catalogue numbers. No new music as such, just a re-release of the LPs. On the third day, it had been re-released with the American cover. You may recall from one of my earlier videos looking at Warner Bros. Releases that this had a completely different cover for the UK release of the initial album. So this is the re-release later in the decade. Jet decided to keep the American cover for that release. So we get in a liner, plain in a liner really, with just the lyrics on it, but it's nice to have it all the same because the initial one didn't have anything. Well, the reason I'm showing you these is because they're all coloured vinyls I've got in the collection. So each of the albums that Jet had under its control at this time, from On the Third Day onwards was re-released in coloured vinyl. So from the third day we get a nice clear vinyl there, ordinary jet labels. So that's really good. These are, I won't say they're dead easy to find, but they are available if you look around record fairs and on eBay, and you'll pay anything from £12 to £15, which isn't particularly expensive, all the way up to 20 or 30 depending on condition. So it won't break the bank to buy these if you want to put them in the collection. Just choose one that's in nice nick. So El Dorado, I'm not going to show you the artwork because you've seen that in the other videos, but El Dorado comes out in a nice yellow vinyl, sometimes called lime vinyl. That's quite nice. So we've got that as well. These first two I'm showing you, these are the originals I bought at the time, and I went into a shop in Stourbridge called Martin's Records at the time, so the large news agents had a record section back then. And I bought both of the albums, not even knowing they were going to be coloured vinyl. I just got them because I wanted them in the collection. And when I got home and opened them up, I realised I'd got two nice coloured vinyls, so I hadn't even purposely bought them like that. Hasty Music, green vinyl, it's very nice. You'll notice these are translucent vinyls, they're not solid colours, they're sort of translucent versions of the colours, and they're quite nice to look at. Newer record, it's a repressing, so no embossed cover on this one. A lot of these will have a sort of day glow sticker on the cover, same coloured vinyl in bright, I think it's blue and red fun. These ones I've got don't, that's probably because I took the sticker off at the time, because sometimes stickers can lead to damage on covers, so I don't always like them on there. So New World Record with the logo on one label as per the original release, and the Jet logo on the other. Red vinyl, very nice, blood red vinyl I think you might call that one. And lastly, Out to the Blue again, and you might guess it's the blue vinyl version. Let's get the one LP out. So that's a sort of clear, nice, translucent blue vinyl there. So this is 1978, this one. And this one, Out the Blue, did come with the poster and the spaceship again, even though it was a limited blue vinyl release, and I have that in this particular release as well. So that's 1978 done. So let's keep this one going. I want to cover 1979 as well. So I'm going to flip to something slightly different now. There's no Roy Wood or Wizard or Move releases going on at the moment. I've done that in the other videos. However, there is another sort of offshoot project from the Yellow at the time, and it's this band called Violinsky. Some of you will have heard of this band and be fully aware of the releases. Others may not, and particularly if you've tuned in from the States, probably you've never even heard of this. So this is Mick Kaminsky's band. This is Mick Kaminsky's the violinist for ELO from around 73, pretty much until the band disbanded in the mid-80s. And he had his own band from college days back in the early 70s, and they were called Cow, as in C-O-W. And they didn't release anything under that title that I'm aware of. But I guess they did maybe College Circuit and Jam Together and stuff like that. And Jet Records decided that they would invest in the band and give them a record deal and get them in the studio. So they did. Mick and colleagues got together and created an album in the late 70s called No Cause for Alarm. The cover, there's a sort of concept cover of this violin being treated like a newborn. Not quite sure where the idea comes from, but I guess it's a little bit effective. The back cover shows the band lining up there. Some of these band members are familiar to long-standing ELO fans. So if I pronounce his surname correctly, Mike de Albuquerque, on lead guitar and vocals. He of course was in ELO for a couple of years in the early 70s. John Hodson drums and percussion. He's one of the main songwriters, very good songwriter. And this is a band effort, really. Several of the band members have got tracks on this LP. And it's a very good album. I just want to make that point in case ELO fans of the late 70s are unaware of it or just haven't bothered listening to it. It is a very good album. It doesn't tend to copy ELO's music style at all, apart from the fact that we've got sort of, I don't know how you'd really say that name. Obviously it's called Violinsky, but it's a bit of a, not an in-joke exactly, but it's a bit on the nose, the name of the band. If they'd have called it something else, it might have been more credible to the wider rock community. Certainly the journalists would want to give it more credibility than it did at the time. But it is really good music. It's a sort of rock, slightly jazz influenced sound. Not that there's any brass instruments on this. I guess the way Mick plays the violin on this is less overproduced than his contributions to the ELO sound. So this is more of a raw band sound. But the songwriting's very good. There's virtually no track on here I don't like. It's not available on CD, so you have to hunt the vinyl out. I'm not going to get it out because there's no inner liner in it, just a plain bag, so there's no point in getting it out of the sleeve. But yeah, I recommend getting hold of this if you can. There is a CD that I've not got on the desk here at the moment called The Best of, or The Very Best of Violinsky, which came out a few years back, no long since deleted. You might have better luck finding that CD because it's got some standout tracks of this LP and some tracks of the second LP that came out the following year, which we'll look at in the next video. And a few outtakes and stuff like that. I recommend getting hold of that. But do try and get the vinyl if you're into collecting vinyl and your ELO collection doesn't have this in it. I really recommend it. There's a couple of singles from that that LP. That got charted. It got, I think, round the top 20, something like that. This is the lead single from it, Clog Dance. It's an instrumental. And although it's an original instrumental written by the band, it's become a well-known piece of music in its own right here in the UK. The northern part of the UK has a lot of history and culture around brass bands and brass band playing. And this piece of music is kind of written in that style, and it's been taken up by a lot of brass bands and has become part of that sort of set list, and may have been covered by one or two other people that like instrumentals. But it's not typical of the album. The album's mainly songs. So this really, although it was a nice catchy tune and it charted, it didn't do the band any favours for their credibility, unfortunately, in my opinion anyway. This one comes out on white vinyl, which is really nice. And that's not difficult to find either, so you should be able to get a hold of that. Probably more so than the LP, to be honest. Right, okay, so the next ELO album up is 8th studio album called Discovery. It's a gatefold sleeve, this one. First time ELO did a gatefold sleeve for a single LP since the early 70s. So what have we got? Well, the concept for this LP, I think, is more exotic mysticism or something like that, with discovering ELO in the form of treasure. Very Arabian Nights feel about it. That's the inside. Just the credits there. There's an inner liner, which has got the four principal band members in the studio at the time in Musicland in Munich, Germany. The string section aren't there. This album, the one before it, Out of the Blue, officially doesn't have the string section performing in the studio. Although I think they may have been hanging around for Out of the Blue and contributed from very small pieces. There's no contribution to this LP. On the reverse sleeve, we get the lyrics and a live shot of the band off the back of their recent world tour. We get another poster. I think the Out of the Blue poster was so popular, Jet Records printed another one. A bit different this time. Instead of portraits, we get band shots and the bands in a film studio. What they're doing here is they're filming the videos for the whole LP. So in terms of video, ELO did a video EP for New World Record and a video EP for Out of the Blue. Some of those tracks are available on VHS in the early 90s. You might find a cassette of the very best of ELO videos on eBay. For Discovery, they didn't really know which songs were going to get selected for single releases, so they decided to just film the entire album. One or two artists had done something similar around that time. I mean, Blondie did the whole of their Eat to the Beat album as a video album. So ELO did the whole of Discovery album. And we get another flyer by the obligatory t-shirts, buttons and badges and so forth. So that was ELO's first number one album as well, by the way. The singles from the album. Lead single, Shining Little Love, top 10, number 6. Their fourth straight single release, good to get number 6 in a row if you discount the EP. Fact fans. And they've reversed the obligatory adverts for the other albums. Second single release is Diary of Horace Wimp. Nice tracks, sort of unusual song. Very good. It's a band cover there. Third single release is a double A, Confusion / Last Train to London. Or was it the fourth? Maybe the fourth. I think the third was Don't Bring Me Down on the back there. And the other band photo of the live set. Yeah, that got to number 3, which was ELO's highest chart position ever in the UK. With Xanadu notwithstanding, because that was a dual thing with Olivia Newton-John, so that got to number 3. This was the fourth single, the double A, Confusion Last Train to London. Nice picture. That's off the artwork that the band had done for American promotion for the Out of the Blue tour. So that was, in terms of UK eyes, that was fresh to UK fans' eyes when it came out, and a picture of the ELO shuckle on the back. This one also got released with a free sticker. So there's the ELO logo as a free sticker with the original issue of Confusion Last Train to London. That's also a demo pressing as well. They're not uncommon. A lot of ELO's late 70s releases and early 80s releases had demo pressings alongside the regular commercial release. So sometimes you can find the demo release as easy as you can the commercial one. Going back to Violinsky, there was a follow-up single, second single from that EP called Save Me, nice ballad. So there's another shot from the band's photo shoot. I think buoyed by the success of the first single, Club Dance, they thought that they would do another coloured vinyl release. This one's on blue vinyl, again, it's another Jet demo record. But it didn't chart, I don't know why, whether it didn't get the airplay, or whether it didn't get into the shops. That wasn't unusual. If Jet Records weren't paying their bills, the distributors didn't get the records out from the warehouse into the shops in time, it didn't sell. And a couple of 12 inches. So from the Discovery LP, we get Shine a Little Love. Now this is on white vinyl. No picture sleeve, just that generic Jet 12-inch cover. The only one I'm aware of in ELO's release that to use a generic 12-inch cover of the Jet logo like that. It's quite nice actually. It came out about the same time as Violinsky's Clog Dance, hence the white vinyl. I think they must have made them on the same run or something. There is a black vinyl version of this, which I didn't know about until recently when I was looking around the internet, but there is one. I've seen it for sale, three figures. It's not cheap. It's probably one of, if not the most rare ELO vinyl record in the UK that was commercially available at the time. I guess it was printed in late in the run, perhaps when this was just peaking in the charts and started to come back down the charts. They ran out of the white vinyl records, so to put records back in the shop, they printed a number of them on black vinyl and put those out, again with generic Jet Records sleeve. So it does exist. Not many were sold, and it's very rare. Three figures if you find it, definitely. Also, second 12 inch was Don't Bring Me Down, which is basically just a repeat of the 7 inch sleeve. Looks a bit better in 12 inch, I think. Another solo release, a bit of an oddity this one. Louise Clark. And to ELO fans, he's known as the string arranger that worked alongside Jeff and Richard Tandy in the studios from, I think, El Dorado onwards. And he did his own LP in the late 70s. I don't have a copy to show you. It's something I'll pick up if I see, but I don't have the LP. But I do have the one single that came from that LP. It's called Escape. The music's instrumental, as you might have guessed if you know Louise Clark's background as an orchestra arranger. He became famous in the UK for Hooked on Classics in the 80s and did a lot of work giving concerts with classical arrangements of popular artists such as ELO and Queen and others. But he had this LP, which is quite hard to find. The single, however, isn't too difficult to find on eBay, although it didn't do anything at the time. I picked up a demo copy of it for a couple of pounds. Right, one final release to show you, which finishes off the 70s and the decade. ELO finally issued an official Greatest Hits LP in the UK. So this is quite common. You'll see this again at boot fairs and shops. The sleeve's become very familiar, although it is a cleverly designed sleeve. It shows the ELO logo as a medal with the Greatest Hits in the medal ribbon at the top there. That's the back, some sleeve notes by Jeff in Jeff's handwriting. It's 11 tracks on the LP, so they don't include anything from Discovery because that LP had only just come out that year. So that was still in the charts probably. So they include three tracks off Out the Blue, which is Turn to Stone, Sweet Talking Woman and Mr. Blue Sky. They don't include Wild West Hero. Probably because they're going to market this in the States as well, and Wild West Hero was not a single release in the States. They include the three hit singles from Newwood Record, Evil Woman and Strange Magic, Can't Get Out of My Head and Mama Bell, and one other, Showdown, which was of course an EMI track, but they got permission to use it on this LP to try and encapsulate ELO's career spanning, including the track from EMI. So we get Inner Liner, band photo on the reverse from the Discovery photo sessions and the lyrics there. The tracks are just lifted straight off the LPs. If you're really keen at listening to the differences between the singles and the LP tracks, you might be able to tell. I can't, although I've not sat down and studied it, but they are just straight renditions off the LP. There's a little flyer there as well. Digital copies of this Greatest Hits album, and you might see that. I was trying to get that in the LPs if I know there's one there. And that's it. That got into the top 10 on the back of Discovery getting to number one. This got to number 7, I think. No single promotion for it. Good LP all the same. That was Jet's first Greatest Hits. Since then, of course, ELO have had Greatest Hits after Greatest Hits after Greatest Hits because of all the CD reissues from different record labels, particularly in the 1990s. But at the time, if you discount only ELO, which wasn't supposed to be released in the UK, that was the compilation to have. And that's it. That's the 70s finished, decade finished. Next video I'm going to do, whenever I get time, will be 1980 to 83. So it will include Time and Secret Messages and a bit of Xanadu stuff. But until then, take care. Any comments, feel free to drop them down, or questions or anything. I'd appreciate that. And I'll see you next time. Bye.